Hi. It's awful bright still out in the sunlight, but it's almost over. All day I've been using this thermos that I found. Believe it or not, I forgot I bought it. But I kept it with the camping equipment, and when I packed up, I put this in with the camping in the car. And a week and a half later, I find it. And you see these ice? I put those ice in there more than 2 hours ago. This really maintains the temperature well. Now, when I pour some more water in here, the ice will melt a little bit because the water's about 90 degrees. No, it's only 80. The water's a little cooler than the air is. It's Monday, and it's awful quiet in the campground. It's always been quiet on weekdays, but this one struck me again. This is the second time I've been through a weekend. I came here a week and a half ago, almost 2 weeks ago. On Wednesday I came here. It's Monday now. In 2 days it'll be 2 weeks since I got here. And I've been through two weekends. And it's crowded and noisy and lots of people, and they parade up and down the road out there going to the bathroom, which is right over there, which is good because I don't have far to walk and I have to go, you know, two or three times a night, being old. But now on Monday, and actually last night too, Sunday morning they started clearing out. The first one showed up on Thursday, and they did that both weeks too. The first week I was here, they showed up the next day or two for the first weekend. And then this week it was quiet on Monday and Tuesday. The past week it was quiet on Monday and Tuesday. And it hardly even melts. I just sit in the shade. I have to move the chair around here and over there, and let's see if I can show you some of the places. I have to move the chair over there by the stove, because in the morning the shadows come in from this way. They come down like this. The sun comes in. The sun comes in from up over there. Boom. And the shadow of that big tree comes down like this. So there's shade there till about noon. And then that part over there gets all lit up in the middle of the day, because see, there's a big gap in the sky. The sun goes cruising right through there until he comes over to this big tree, which is right where I am right now. This big tree. Yeah, I'm below the big tree, and my car is parked right over there below the other big tree. There's two big trees, and there's even one right here that's split. Let's see if you can see it. Yes, you can see there. It's got a Y, a big V. And there's another tree beyond that, and they shade the car most of the time. So, of course, yeah, the tent. It's a nice tent. It's a big, tall tent, but I have to take it down. I'm leaving. Not tomorrow. I might take it down tomorrow, but I'll leave early the next day. I'm quite content with this site. It's a beautiful site. It only cost me $10 a night, which is within my budget. And I'm looking now at some of the beach parks, even if they have vacancies, they're still going to cost $20, $30, $40, $50 a night. Mm-mm. This is a $20 campsite, but because I have a senior pass, I had it for $10. That's part of the forest. Good thing about the National Forest camping, so you can get a discount. So, I have to leave here. I'm going to leave here. Probably day after tomorrow morning. I don't want to leave in the middle of the day, except that when I drove to the store today at 10:30 in the morning, there's a store here on top of the mountain, just 3 miles down from the campground. Went to the store to buy some more ice, which makes it possible for me to exist for another 2 days in the heat wave. Man, it's fierce. It's fierce, but it's like that everywhere in Southern California. And I'm right smack dab in the middle of Southern California and the Santa Ana Mountains. Close to home, almost to L.A. L.A. So here we are, sitting in my campground, and it's evening, and the sun is going through some low clouds. It's a possibility of thunder showers, which is why I have the tent all covered with the rain fly here. That's a separate item, covers the whole tent. The back of the tent is all open to the mesh to the air, but that's covered by the rain fly now. Anyhow, last night was my 12th night, tonight is my 13th, and tomorrow night will be my 14th, and you're only allowed 14 nights by the rule, by the law. You have to move somewhere else. So, legally, I'm bound to leave, but it's been a good stretch here. I found a place where I could sit back, which is what I like to do. I like to go places, and sit down, and sit back and do some writing, and do some reading, and that's my papers are right down here. I'm looking down at my notebook, and underneath that, the book I'm reading. I'm reading this book about the county where my grandmother grew up. It's called Prairie Earth, and it's by William Least Heat Moon. So you can see how far along through it I am. I've gotten that far. I'm getting close to the end now. I've been reading it for about a month. And now that I've managed to do it and get out here alone by myself, of course I brought this book with me. It was really, really good. It was good the first time I read it 20 years ago, and it's good now. Well, it's actually even better now because I feel a little more like I know the writing a little better than I did the first time I read it. He's one of those writers who talks right to you and says, hey, come walk with me here in the prairie. Come on, I'll show you something. And it's a good trip. It's a good voyage with him in his canoe up the Cottonwood River. He doesn't actually go in a canoe up the river. That's a metaphor on my part. He walks around, and he has his van that he drives around in. Sometimes he sits and sleeps in the van. But he made this whole thing of visiting for months and months and months, visiting the county in Kansas that has hills and a little bit of prairie left in it. And he did a good job of writing, in my opinion. At least it's the kind of book I like to read. And then I've been writing in my notebook. I'm looking down at that too. That's right there. There's a chair here with all these papers piled up on it, including my emergency radio, which I use to keep track of the weather. Yes, well, so I can get the details of the weather, and I know there's a huge high system out there floating over the North Pacific, and we're just being baked. Baked. I keep wondering if I'm going to see the lights go out, because, you know, all around the horizon there's a faint glow of white from the cities of Los Angeles and Orange County and San Diego and Riverside and San Bernardino. There's this whole circle of cities around these mountains, the Santa Ana Mountains. And I'm sitting up here looking at it every night, and I can see more stars here than I can in San Diego, but there's still light pollution. I can't see the Milky Way real clear. I can see a faint hint of a Milky Way, but it's nothing like I've seen it before out in the desert. Well, it was 10 times brighter than it is here. But this is the silver lining, or is it the gray cloud? The really dark and gloomy part of it, though, is the heat. Even now, is still quite warm. Although the sun's not shining on me. It's shining over on the trees over there. And it comes shining through here. The sun comes shining through the trees. And there's one right up there. You can see where the sun is shining on the leaves. Kind of from the side. Yeah, you know, the tree is lit from the side because the sun is shining in there from an angle. It's only about 30 degrees above the horizon now. It's not way up high anymore. It's coming down. The sun is coming down. And over there are some more trees. You can see how they catch the light like that. Yes, the trees are all lit up because there we go. Because the sun is shining on them, so they're all lit up. But as the time goes on, as these minutes go on, the sun is going lower and lower behind me, and the light on the, see the light on the dry grass behind the fire grill there? That's my coffee pot on top of there. See, that light will slide up the hillside as the sun is going down 180 degrees away over there. Yes, it will. It will be sliding up through the tree and all down and into the screen house. And yes. That's how it goes. The sun goes down. And it's still lighting up the grass around here and coming through the trees and holes and places, but it's going down. Right now the sun's about that angle. I'm pointing up to the sun right there. Fingers are right in front of it, in front of my eyes. So that's about 30 degrees up, and it's got about an hour and a half before it comes down and starts going behind the mountain and the trees that are, there's a mountain over there. That way, there's a mountain going by that way and a mountain over that way. And we're sort of on the, this little campground is in the bowl of hills in front of a couple of taller mountains. And it's a very pretty place, except it's too hot. But once I got here, I didn't want to leave. I liked it, and especially like this time of day here. It's well lit, but not too bright to kill you. Like if I had to go to the toilet right now, I could walk the 50 yards over there to the outhouse and I wouldn't suffer much in the sun. But a couple hours ago, last time I went, it was about 2 o'clock and it was damn hot out there. And I had my hat on. I had my sun hat on like this, but I could feel it beating right through the hat, and my arms were like, you gonna be tan after this, boy. I should take my shirt off and get me a fat brown tan. Maybe people think I'm Hawaiian or something. Look at that big fat Hawaiian chief. Oh, it ain't the alcohol. It's the heat exhaustion that makes me go loony. I've been watching very closely. And every time I do the least thing at all in this heat, I start feeling a little tired, a little faint. It's like, Sit down in the shade. Drink some more icy drink. This thing insulates the ice so well that there's hardly any melted in there. I filled up 3-gallon jugs from the water tap about an hour ago when I first started getting active again. It's feeding time at the zoo. The animals are getting active. Well, after sitting in this chair like I am now for several hours reading and writing, the only break was when, like I mentioned, I went to the bathroom 2 or 3 hours ago. 3 hours ago. But other than that, I'm sitting pretty still until just about 45 minutes, an hour ago, when I went over and first dug out there's a bottle and a can and a plastic bottle and a coffee can that I tossed into the fire pit because that was a convenient trash pit. But I was thinking about having a fire tonight, so I took them out, and then I took the bits of paper trash out too and put them in another box where I'm collecting real trash that I want to trash instead of recyclable trash like the glass and the plastic and the can. So I cleaned out the fire pit a little bit, and it was only a few minutes, but I noticed that it didn't make me feel as tired as walking to the toilet had 2 hours before that. Here comes an aircraft. So I was cleaning out the fire pit, and who should come by but the ranger doing his one afternoon check of the grounds. So I raised my hand like this. I saw him inside his cab with the door windows closed, probably air conditioned. I saw him raise his hand back at me. And I thought, well, isn't that convenient? He saw me with a shovel at the fire pit. Sounds like Ranger Rick and the Good Camper. That is so silly. You hear that? There was a helicopter here. Was it just yesterday? Was it Sunday? No, it was the day I went to the store, so it was Saturday. I didn't go to the store Sunday. I've gone every 2 days, pretty much, since I've been up here. I went to the store day before yesterday on Saturday, and there was a helicopter hovering over there, and there were fire and ambulance and a couple of cop cars back over in the parking area, the entrance to the campground. And I thought maybe somebody fainted on the trail. I told you about the guy I saw on, good heavens, when was it? It was Friday, I think. No, it was Thursday. Whatever it was a few days ago. And I saw this guy, and I thought he was dead by the side of the road. Well, I went to the store to get ice and called 911, and the store people called 911, and I led the fire truck there, and the guy was alive. But he never came back. They took him away, and they left his broken bicycle there. It's still there. Days later, it's still there, so I hope he was all right. But I was afraid. I've talked about this before. I'm having deja vu. I already did this. I thought I saw a body by the side of the road. I did that before. And I said that I felt like a coward because I was afraid to get out and touch him. He wasn't moving. Well, when we came back, me and the fire truck, he was moving, but he was sitting down and acting real, real fatigued. I wanted to give him water, but the fireman said, no, no. We assess him and we give him what he needs. You just stay out of it. I thought, oh. And I said, so I should, go back to the campground now. He said, yes. And then the next day I thought maybe it was another rescue, but I don't know. I just don't know. I haven't talked to them except, hi, how are you, warm enough, etc. Yesterday, I talked to the ranger who came out end of Sunday and dug around in the fire pit across the road here. There's another campsite across the road, across the campground road, and he dug in there. There must have been something smoldering, or maybe not, I don't know, but he dug in it for some reason. And I said hi as he was at the water tap, which is right behind me here. Lots of people come there. I can see them get water there. It's very interesting. You see people and learn things about how people talk. Coming to the waterhole. And he came to the waterhole because, you know, he's working, he needs water for putting out the fire. And I said, hi. He said, oh, hi, how you doing? I said, well, all right, except it's a little warm. And he said, oh, yeah, it's toasty up here, isn't it? So that was the extent of my words with the ranger. No, that's not true. Several days ago, I talked to some others and asked them about the 14-day limit and things like that, and whether you could move to another national forest or just to another part of the same national forest. And they said, oh, you better ask the office about that. And I said, oh, you guys aren't lawyers? They laughed. And so it's been a good stay. I've talked to the rangers twice and the firemen once. Oh, and I waved to the ranger again today, so. Waved to him yesterday, too, when he drove by after digging up the fire pit. So anyhow, I was going to have a fire and cook weenies tonight, but I don't want to work. I mean, I'd picked up the trash out of the fire pit. I think that's a good thing to do. And I broke up some of the wood, and I looked at it, and I went, you know, a potential fire is almost as beautiful as a real fire. Because right over there, you see it shining in my eyes? The sun insists on shining through the trees. There, you see it? That's sunlight coming through the leaves of the branches. And it's pretty strong out there. Let me tell you, it's pretty strong. And this is the mild time of day, the golden hour, when it's all calm and everything. I charged the camera today with my solar panel. One good thing about the sun is it charges. I have this little solar panel that's about 4 feet long and about 11 inches high. It's like 4 8.5 by 11 pages side by side. It folds up like a little notebook, and it unfolds into 4 panels, and it delivers 12 volts if the sun is shining. And I charge this camera with it so that I have more than an hour of battery time. Of course, that's not counting the zoom. You see, when you zoom in and out, Daniel, you use up power. So I have to be careful with that part. I discovered that a long time ago. I love this camera, but it's old. It's getting old. The wire on the plug is starting to break apart. Oh, poor little fat old man. His camera is getting old. You know, there are people dying of starvation. And I complain about an old camera. I should be singing the Messiah in gratitude for just having one afternoon at sunset. And here I've had 13 afternoons so far. Even the day when I was gone all day long, I got back before sunset, and I had this golden hour I had on the Sunday that I drove down to San Diego and picked up more stuff and put stuff away, and all that. It was a week ago yesterday. Yesterday I was so happy I didn't have to go drive anywhere. But I am thinking about where I'm going next. And really, the challenge is, how do I get to the beach? How do I get to the beach where the temperature is only 80 instead of 100? Or 80 instead of 95? It's been warm up here today. I wouldn't be surprised if it had been 100, but I stayed out of it successfully. The first 3 days it was merely warm, but these last 3 days it's been hot. 4 days it's been hot. Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday. Yep. And I've been very happy because I made a good choice to come here. It's safe. It's beautiful. It's oak forests on the hillside, which is what I wanted to see. And it was a whole new place for me. I've never been here before. Most other places I thought about going, I've been once or several times. Up in the Lagunas or up Palomar. But I'd never even been up the highway here, let alone get off onto the forest road and come up the side of the mountain, come up halfway up the top of the mountain to this campground. Blue jay, hanging at an elevation of 3,300 feet above sea level. It's not high altitude, but it's not desert valley. It's mountain hillside. Mediterranean mountain hillside with oaks and brow. This place right here is a dream because it's like a little veil floating on the mountain and there's trees all over it. It's a little forest held up above the valleys. I'm going on a long time and wasting the camera's battery power, not to mention your patience, but I did want to make a video log today as the sun settles down into its golden hour. And I wanted you to see and hear the insects. But now it's been so hot that even the gnats are not so nasty. The nasty gnats. I wrote that in my journal first. G-N-A-S-T-Y, G-N-A-T-S. Well, that's a kind of a fly. There's several varieties. The best ones, though, are the yellow jackets. But I sort of just, except for telling them to leave me alone, I pretty much leave them alone. I set out some water for them. Water. That reminds me. I wonder if the ice has melted any. About 1 teaspoon. That is so wonderfully insulated. Mmm. I also wanted to introduce an old friend, but he's lying back with my jackets in the pile of clothes that I need to figure out how to put away and yet have them if it gets really cold. But I don't think it's going to get real cold. The first night I was here, I wore a jacket, and the second night I was here, I wore a jacket because the temperature dropped to the 60s, even threatened to go to the 50s because it's 3,000 feet above sea level and the sky was clear and the heat went out. But now, with the heat wave, there's this huge dome of high-pressure air over the whole western continent, and it's warm. So, I don't need a jacket at night, no. But about 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning, the first couple of nights, it got so cold, because I was sleeping outside the whole time. There's only, I think, 2 nights when I slept inside the tent. Other times I either sleep sitting up. I like to sleep sitting up. I've done that for years. I can sleep sitting up. Maybe that's part of being old and fat, but I'm not very diagnostic about it, actually. Beautiful highway. I love that old highway in the north coast of San Diego County. You go through the old towns that are all built up now, and then you go across the lagoons and where the water comes down from inland from the dry streams, but they turn into lagoons that the tide washes in and out. And then you go by the beaches, and you go up into the next town. There's like a little string of beach towns there. You don't really see them from the freeway. You just go through suburbia. But on the old highway, you go through the centers of the old beach towns. And it parallels the railroad a lot, because the railroad was the... That was there when they built the first beach towns. So anyhow, I'm sitting here watching the sun sink lower into the trees, thinking that I'm still wasting your time and my time, even though I said I'm wasting my time and your time. I'm just amazed how that ice doesn't melt in that thermos. It's called Stanley Master Series. I made coffee today, and I had some fruit juice and some nuts, and I was thinking I'd be hungry enough to roast a hot dog, but I ain't. I was going to open a can of refried beans, because this is how I made the hot dogs. Was it as long as a week ago? I think it was. I think it was last week. I made hot dogs, and I had these hot dog rolls. And first, I split the roll open, and then I opened the can of refried beans, and they're not juicy like baked beans or something else. They're just refried beans, you know, they're pasty. And I took a knife and scooped some out and spread it up and down the hot dog bun on both sides. And then I held the hot dog over the fire and burned it all around and cooked it all around. And this stick, you can turn it around. You don't have to actually turn your hand. It's got a little knob. You can turn it and the thing rotates. And it's got these two prongs that stick it right into the dog, you know, boom. You can rotate the dog around. Oh, excuse me, like this. Whatever. It rotates. And you hold it like that and get it all hot and burnt up. 4 minutes. I'm running out of time. Well, I guess this will be it. So I had hot dogs, and then you take the burnt dog and you set it down on that bun that's all spread with baked beans, refried beans. And it's really kind of tasty. Very simple, straightforward. Of course, I forgot to bring mustard. I better quit. It says 4 minutes, warning. Well, I charged this camera today, and I sure have been using my money's worth gabbing at you. So I will simply say, God bless you and good night. And this is me from the Santa Ana Mountains, Daniel. And today was the 29th day of the moon, 59th day of summer in the Northern Hemisphere, in the 63rd year of the space age, which is to say, August 17th, 2020, Monday. Bye.